Okay guys, time to unbox and review some new Z690 motherboards. First up, the MSI MPG Z690 Carbon Wi-Fi. Hey guys, welcome and welcome back to my channel RealMelTan. 12th Gen or Alder Lake CPUs has just dropped! Woo! Unfortunately, I don't have any of these new CPUs on hand, but before we get to the motherboard, let's see what MSI has put inside this box. Okay, let's open it up. Alright, first thing in this box, your antenna for Wi-Fi 6E and Bluetooth 5.2. Motherboard's already out. Very important user guide. New motherboard, make sure to check out the new user guide. Next up, one LED J corset cable. I'll explain to you what this does later in the video, so make sure to stay tuned. One LED J rainbow cable for your RGB, for your ARGB actually. A pair of SATA cables, one JRGB Y cable, no CD but a thumb drive that contains your drivers and utilities. I would still prefer that you download the latest drivers from the MSI website, so yeah. This is a brush, I guess you use this to clean off the dust from your motherboard because motherboards can get very dirty. So there's both a fine one here, as well as a thicker one here. I still wouldn't recommend you to use this to dust off your motherboard socket. Okay, so this is a small screwdriver set for your M.2 devices. We have first seen this in our B550 gaming carbon Wi-Fi video. So yeah, you can check it out. And lastly, a pair of what do you call this? Easy M.2 lockers. So MSI, I've seen what you have done here. We have probably taken some good learnings from the other RAID company and probably from Gordon also. His feedback and advice probably gave you this idea, I don't know. But yeah, it's very similar to what you see for the M.2 storage on the other RAID company. I'm going to also go through how this works in the later part of the video, so yeah. Okay, back to the motherboard. First thing is you'll see the very well-recognized black color scheme of the MSI Carbon series. Very black, very carbon fiber-ish. But of course, we're not here to talk about how pretty the motherboard is. The centerpiece here, of course, is a new LGA 1700 socket, surrounded by fairly thick VRM heatsinks, a good number of capacitors and chokes. Word of caution, this new socket only uses Alder Lake or 12th Gen CPUs. Please do not try to install your 11th Gen or lower CPUs into this new socket. Which brings us to the CPU power, two 8-pin ATX power connectors. I do not know how much power do these new CPUs actually consume, but since the previous generation, the Z590 Carbon also has two 8-pin, maybe we can safely assume that Alder Lake uses the same amount of power as Rocket Lake. But I also hear things that Alder Lake is going to run hotter and run a lot crazier than Rocket Lake. I'll guess I will know when I actually get my hands on the Alder Lake CPU. Next, there are 4 DIMM slots here for you to install 4 sticks of RAM up to 128GB. You can do single channel, dual channel or quad channel. Second word of caution, not DDR4 but DDR5. The key notch on DDR5 is slightly different to DDR4, so do not try to install your DDR4 RAM into these new slots. And also before I forget, non-ECC RAM. I do not know how much faster does DDR5 RAM actually perform to DDR4, but make sure to smash the subscribe button to see if I get my hands on DDR5 RAM. Okay, next, before I get to the main section, let me walk you through some headers which I think you should know. The CPU fan header as well as the palm header are in their standard locations. There are two ARGB headers here and here, as well as one RGB header here. The debug code LED is here, and I would like to especially mention the J corset connector here. So, when will we want to use this? Let's say you have a bunch of corset fans and you want to control the RGB on these fans. Instead of having both Mystic Light Sync as well as Corset IQ to control the RGB on the motherboard as well as the fans, you can connect the fans onto a Corset RGB fan hub and connect the fan hub onto this J Corset connector. With that, you can control the RGB on the corset fans using MSI Misty Light Sync, as well as your other RGB accessories such as RAM and GPU. Very good thing to have, and it's no longer exclusive to the B550 Gaming Carbon Wi-Fi.
It's exclusive to the B550 Gaming Carbon Wi-Fi.
I also like that this board has no shortage of fan headers, up to 6. One of them, C-Span 1, is at a very nice location on the left. This is great to have because now you don't need to route your exhaust fan wire all the way to the right side of the motherboard. The connector is just here. Other headers to note are the clear CMOS jumper here. Unfortunately, no clear CMOS button on this motherboard. The Thunderbolt header is here. Which brings us to the front I/O, one USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-C front, one USB 3.2 Gen 1 next to the Type-C, as well as two other USB 2.0 Type-A connectors here. And to round this part up, I also like to mention this switch called the Easy LED Control. If you have a lot of RGB on this board and perhaps you want to go for the all black look, or are installing this motherboard inside a case with no side window, you can flick the switch on this Easy Fan Control and all of the RGB on the motherboard will turn off. If you're feeling happy again, just flick it back on and you'll see all your RGB back on. But to note, this works for all RGB except for those on your RAM sticks. Okay, so now to the main section. For storage, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 5 M.2 slots as well as 6 SATA ports. This is going to be a slightly long chapter, so bear with me for a while. The 5 SATA ports, SATA 5, 6, 7, 8 are regular SATA ports and are controlled by the chipset. The other two, SATA A and B, are from S-Media ASM1061. A point of note is that if you were to plug in the SSD inside the 4th M.2 slot, SATA port number 7 will turn off. So why is that an issue when you still have 3 SATA ports? I'm not going to go into so much with this S-Media ASM1061, but for what I've seen on my research, the two SATA ports A and B are what I call them half bandwidth SATA ports. If you really want to max out your storage on this motherboard, I recommend that you use up all 5 M.2 slots and the 3 SATA ports and use the last 2 SATA ports as a final resort, because you will not get the full speed of a regular SATA port compared to the first 4 SATA ports. But hell, you're already spending money on Intel 12th Gen and a nice motherboard like this. I think the better option will be to max out the 5 M.2 slots and actually get a NAS for your backup as well as bigger files. Which brings us to the 5 M.2 slots. But before that, let me remove all of the M.2 slot covers first. All 3 of them come with their own thermal padding material. Unlike the full captive screws I see on other motherboards, I will call this the half-captive heat shield covers. Because you see, some of them have a standard screw connected to them and some of the screws come off. This applies to the last M.2 slot cover, the mid M.2 slot cover, as well as the first M.2 slot cover. It's going to be a bit of a challenge later when I actually talk about the new easy clips on this new motherboard, because yeah, it's actually not what I expected. But let's go on to that in a while. Okay, so first things first, let's just talk about the M.2 slot configuration. The first slot with additional thermal padding at the bottom is reserved for your main NVMe SSD. It runs at PCIe 4.0 x4 speed. I'm actually kind of surprised because I thought it would run at PCIe 5.0 x4 speed. I guess MSI probably reserved PCIe 5, such as their more advanced motherboards such as the Ace and Godlike. But anyway, the other slots also run at PCIe 4.0 x4 except for the 4th slot, which runs at PCIe 3.0 x4. If you have M.2 SATA devices, not NVMe, you can plug them in M.2 slots 4 and 5. I'm not going to go into so much detail as to what kind of SSDs you can plug to which slots, but if you want to know, you can write down the comments and I'll get back to you. Okay, so now this is where the fun begins. Do you remember this guy, the Easy M.2 clip? I'm going to show you how it works right now. So you can see on the board, there are sub slots with the clips. There are two on the first slot. There is one on the third slot. There is one on the last slot. So how do you install these clips? Very simple. You can actually separate the two. Yep, so this is the head, is the bottom. The bottom works similar to M.2 standoff. You can install into the same places as you do for M.2 standoff. And you will put the head, the one with the retention clip, on top of the stand-up. I'm going to take this out first because I'm going to show you something which I have an issue with. Okay, I have my trusty 980 Pro over here. So, first slot works like a charm. Very simple. Plug it in and yeah, just rotate the clip. Yeah, and the SSD is installed. Remember to also remove the bottom heat padding material before you install your SSD for real. Okay, second one. So this guy doesn't have the easy clip. It has a M.2 standoff already installed. So you probably need to use a more common M.2 standoff screw to fix this SSD heat. So I was curious, I actually wanted to try whether you can actually use the easy clip. So let me just remove this standoff. Gonna install the easy clip. Just a warning, these things are very tiny, especially the retention clip screw, so make sure you handle them properly and don't lose them. I've lost them a few times. Oh my god, my fingers are so big. This is a part where it's good to have a screwdriver that is magnetized because it actually makes it easier to screw in this small screw.
A few moments later.
Okay, it is finally in. Alright, so back to our SSD. Okay. Yeah, I cannot close the M.2 heat cover because there is now an additional screw over here that's actually blocking it off. So it works well if you're using a regular M.2 standoff. So I don't know how to rectify this, unfortunately. There is no room for this screw to be screwed on because the correct M.2 standoff is not here anymore. So I'm not so sure if I'm doing this wrong or maybe this slot you can only use the regular M.2 standoff screw. Just tested, M.2 third slot is fine. Yeah, but if you can't resolve the issue with the second M.2 slot, you can't put back the M.2 heat cover on the middle section. Same thing also applies to the 4th and 5th M.2 slots. The 4th slot here does not have the easy clip and also no standoff, so I guess you can use easy clip for this slot. This last one is a big one. So you can see here, it comes with both the easy clip as well as the M.2 standoff. So you can see the length of my SSD. I will need to use this M.2 standoff. But the easy clip here is blocking, sort of, because it's kind of high. And I've just tried, I'm not able to remove the standoff from this easy clip because it seems to be glued to the motherboard. So I'm not so sure why I'm not able to do so. Okay, let me try something. Can we actually put the easy clip on the M.2 standoff? Okay, no, we can't. Perhaps you can actually put an easy clip over here.
A few moments later.
Okay, much difficulty. Back to the last slot. Yeah, it doesn't work because of this easy clip in the middle. Yeah, just try it. I can't seem to remove it. Yeah, so I'm not going to spoil the motherboard just to test this. Hopefully, I'm not showing you guys wrong, but this is what I see with this motherboard. So I'll probably discuss this with Gordon again. But if you guys also have any suggestions, feel free to write down in the comments below. And yeah, any form of advice would be great. Okay, to all you guys who stay on to the M.2 part, thank you so much. Let's now go on to the PCIe slots. So we have three PCIe slots. The first two PCIe slots with the heat shields run at PCIe 5.0x16, not 4.0, 5.0x16. Of course, you will want to use your first PCIe slot for your most powerful device, such as your main GPU. If you want to use two PCIe devices, such as two GPUs, you'll run at x8 and x8 speed each. The last slot, controlled by chipset, runs at PCIe 3.0x4. Mentioned earlier, you can run a Thunderbolt card, a sound card, or capture card in that slot. Okay guys, just to show you how it looks like with PCIe devices on it. I have my giant GPU here, 3080 Ti, gonna put that in the first slot, of course. And I also have a smaller one, a 3060, in the second slot. Okay, so you can see that having two PCIe devices such as two GPUs on this motherboard will block off the last PCIe slot. So you can't put any sound card, capture card, or Thunderbolt on this motherboard if you have two GPUs sitting on this motherboard. But I actually don't see anyone doing this in the long run. NVLink on RTX cards are only on 3090, and I actually don't see anyone running Crossfire even though this board supports Crossfire. One giant badass GPU on the first PCIe 5.0 existing slot is good enough. So yeah, one GPU. Okay, so now let's go on to the back I.O. Going from left to right, we have the BIOS flashback button, 4 USB 2.0 ports, 1 DisplayPort 1.4 and 1 HDMI 2.1. Yup, if you're buying this board, you probably, like just now, use a very high-end GPU for this motherboard. You will probably not use the DisplayPort or HDMI on this motherboard. But that's it. If there's something wrong with motherboard and you can't find your GPU, you can easily plug into either the HDMI or DisplayPort onto a monitor and you can see what's wrong in the BIOS. Okay, next to HDMI and DisplayPort, there are 5 USB 3.2 Gen 2 Type-A ports. Those are in red and they run at 10 Gbps. The one on the bottom is to flash your BIOS, so this works with the flash BIOS button. If you ever want to flash this motherboard's BIOS without having a CPU or RAM plugged in, you just take the BIOS, put inside a thumb drive, plug into this port and just press the flash BIOS button. Below the red Type-A port is another USB 3.2 Gen 2x2 Type-C port. Above is an Intel 2.5G LAN. Next to those are your Go connectors for your Wi-Fi antenna, giving you Wi-Fi 6E and Bluetooth 5.2. You also have 5 audio jacks and an optical SPD out. Okay, so what do I think about this motherboard? Of course, there are both pros and cons to this new Z690 motherboard. The pros are one thing, of course, I've heard mentioned. The I/O shield is now on the motherboard. You don't need to worry about not having this before you install the motherboard into the case. The next thing, of course, is the number of storage devices that you have right now. 5 M.2 slots compared to the Z590, which only has 4. 6 SATA ports, more than enough storage capacity for what you need. But as mentioned before, if you ever want to max out this board, just go for the 5 M.2, get a NAS drive, more than enough space. Yeah, don't use the SATA ports if possible. Yeah, anyway. Now for the cons, I would definitely wish for the first slot to be a PCIe 5. And the other big issue is the issue with easy clips. I do not know if I'm doing wrong or yeah, it's probably some design flaw in the motherboard. I can't put back the heat shields when I have some of the easy clips on. So yeah, maybe MSI can update me. The MSI has definitely advanced the Z590, a mid-range motherboard, to this mid to high-end motherboard. I have not seen the other motherboards yet, but the gaming carbon has always been a mainstay for this range. So yeah. So if you like my review of this board, make sure to smash the thumbs up button. Write down in the comments what do you think about this motherboard, and if you want to know what kind of SSDs you can put in the which slots, let me also know. And if you have any idea on this easy clip issue, you can also write down in the comments. And in the meantime, you can check out the review of the MSI B550 Gaming Carbon Wi-Fi. Make sure to come back to our channel because we are going to review more Z690 motherboards next few days. Yeah. So I hope to see you in the next video, and with that, I say goodbye.